Every Sunday I would go to church with my mama. She said, if you want to go to church and you want to play music in the church, you're going to play music in the church, you want to go the other way, that's your business. I said, yes, ma'am, I'm going the other way. That's what I'm trying.
Friend I ever had. No, it was my dear old dad. Only friend I ever had. No, it was my dear old dad. Used to say, son, think about your future and please forget to pay.
It came from the South. It's a reminder of hard times, depression, slavery, and just being black.
Well, on plantation, the slaves had messages through song. They could sing, hey, you better tighten up now, the boss is here, you know, things of that sort. Nobody understood what they were talking about, but the slaves did. They knew what he was talking about. That meant the boss is on the way, you better, whatever you're doing, get back to it.
See, the blues come from like people in slavery time, back in slavery working, and they sang holler songs to make the day pass longer. You know, you be tired and don't know how you're gonna make your time or whatever, don't know when you're gonna get out, and you heard, oh, my black name around, you know, all up and down the line.
Please, your captain, sink 'em low, boy, raise 'em high.
At the age of 8, I was plowing that mule good. Age of 9, I was plowing 2 mules. They call it a turning plow. And I was working for 30 cents a day from sun up to sundown. That didn't give me the blues about work. One thing that gave me blues was I always felt bad because I didn't have nothing to play with or nobody to play with. I didn't know what to play with. I'd be glad if my mother throw away a spool, get through with a spool and throw it away. I'd take a piece of wire and put on a piece of wire and make a wagon out of it.
The plantation owner would have people to work on his plantation. Usually they say rent free, but he gives you what we call a furnished, which is an advance.
Whether you kept records of it or not, the big man kept the records, so you were very fortunate sometimes at the end of the year, like in December. You were very fortunate if you came out with a profit. They would always say, you almost cleared the books. Almost.
When you're sharecropping, if you make 20 bales of cotton, the boss get 10 and you get 10. But out of your 10 bales of cotton, you got to pay the boss all the money you borrowed all the year from him out of your 10s. So when you pay him, you ain't got nothing.
At the end of the year, every year, my father got paid. And the way he got paid, it was not in money. He got paid by getting a big barrel, like that high from the ground. He got a big barrel of flour, a tin can of what we call molasses, and then they give us another can of lard. That was my father's pay, and that's all he got.
Most of the time, not in all of the cases, but most of the time you would find yourself getting deeper and deeper in debt to the point that you could never move.
Sink 'em low, boy. Sink 'em low. Sink 'em low, boy. Raise 'em high.
I was born in Rankin County. That's east of Jackson, Mississippi. That's where I was born and raised there. And I was taken out east, I sent a place they call it Egypt. It's on the other side of the tackle box. I was out there, kid out there when I was a baby, I didn't know nothing about it. When I couldn't know anything, I was 9 years old, my mother brought me back in this down here. And I've been around Como all around in here all of my days.
Like what they call Hill Country, we're hoping where great Othar Turner and them come from. When I hear people like Othar then, I hear the same blues inside of it. I hear the flute playing little things like. I hear this percussion effect that Othar and I play with. I hear that.
Played the guitar, mandolin, ukulele, and banjo, and he made these little penny whistles and blow it, huh? He used to cut a little sapling about that long, and he'd take his pocket knife and start a little place at the end, and he'd take a piece of wire, a number 10 piece of wire, a fencing wire, and we'd pull the lid off the stove and put it in the fire, huh? And he'd get it blood red hot.
Yeah, it is. That's what I need.
And he keep jobbing it in now till he burn a hole all the way through it. And then he would cut 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 holes across the top.
Every time.
And he would blow it and work them holes with his fingers.
As you can blow it. It's sure, it's just like talking. It ain't there. That's right, it ain't there.
Hey! Hey! What?
Picnic didn't used to seem like no picnic if it wasn't no drums there. I used to be in the field playing, man, and hear them drums at them picnics. I'd be wanting night to come so bad, I'd be, man, crying about it for night to come. I'd be out there playing the mule. Soon as night come, I'd be gone. I'd take him out and I'd be going to the picnic, man.
Gotta get it.
Yeah, y'all.
Got to have some rest now, man.
The way the blues came about, my uncle, he used to buy Blind Lemon Jefferson, all those old. Said, boy, come back here and listen to this.
Gypsy rider, you see what you done done, made me love you, now you're pretty strong.
Because I didn't see him much. He was a blind man, I couldn't lead him around. I didn't know where to take him, and I wasn't allowed to go there no way. And I done got to be about 10, 11 years old. And, But you wouldn't have no trouble recognizing calling me. Talk like that. Real fine and loud. There ain't no more sweet potatoes. The frost can kill the vines. Blues ain't nothing but a good gal on your mind. That's the first song I ever heard by him. And I learned it back in them days.
Well, the blues ain't nothing but a good woman on your mind.
but I think Blind Blake had more influence on most people around where I grew up in. And my Uncle Jeffers, he went just stone crazy when he heard Blind Blake's Black Dog Blues.
All my life I've been a traveling man.
He's the greatest guitar finger picker that I'd ever heard on record. I shipped my truck down to Tennessee. I shipped my truck down to Tennessee. It's hard to tell, but a man like me. And you know Blake disappeared, nobody's ever heard of him again. I'm Fred Two Boys around your house at night, one of my favorite songs. I'm afraid to balls around your house that night. That police don't get mean and full of fire.
Up in the morning, sing around your
bed. People like Charlie Patton and them, they just fight the guitar down on the bass strings like this.
I found this old WAP record of Charlie Patton in the garbage, where you take your garbage, because they had dumps where you take your garbage. The rebels, the record was so WAP. But I liked it then. I liked it.
Yeah, I liked it, Charlie. Yeah, Charlie was. He could beat that guitar, beat all the paint off down there, man. He beating all that. He drumming and playing all the same time.
I knew there was something to this stuff, man. You know, although I couldn't understand what he was talking about or saying, but it came out in the music line. That old I tell you. You know what I'm talking about? I said, oh, this guy done had a bad night.
Well, I tell you, I never did go around him too much. I went some to place where he played at, you know. And they'd stand outdoors and listen to him, because I was a little fella. He wouldn't let me in the house. And he'd play on store porches, you know, like there on the porch, and I'd go down and look at him, and all that kind of stuff. So I was too little to go into places, you know, where he was at. Yeah. I was young then, I was around about 8 or 9 or 10 years old.
Know you, darling.
And they called it a stove porch. It's a stove porch frolicking, have a good time on the stove porch. This little stove here was called Mr. Willie Bass Plantation. And all the plantation people did would meet up on a Saturday, drink, and have fun right here.
They be dancing sometimes, dancing out on the ground, out in front of the, you know, the stove porch, you know, or the commissary, they call them. They'll be out there on the ground dancing, you know. Yeah. So that's what I said to myself, when I get big enough, I'm going to make them dance, too, and I did.
So my mama went and bought one of them now, what you call it? You're cranking, man. You know what I'm talking about?
Back in all the days, people didn't know the true pronunciation of it. They would say graftophone.
My mom's aunt, but young, very young, like my mother was. And she would buy records like teenagers do today, a lot of them. And she kept up with everybody that come out. So there was Blind Lemon, Reverend Gary Davis, my cousin Booker White, Blind Boy Fuller, and a few others like that. That was her favorites. When I was a good boy visiting her, she would always let me play the records on her Victrola. And believe me, I had a halo around my head when I was over to her house.
It was a little better. It was a little better when I, but it still had that. And so I couldn't understand what he was talking about. But I could understand the music.
These sounds was something like I'd never heard before. And they seemed to do things for me. It's like when you have a toothache and somebody can give you something that stops the toothache. That's the way their music was. That's soothing to me.
You didn't even hear black music on radio. Only black music you heard was on that Victrola. And you heard songs like Bessie Smith, Ida Cox, Mamie Smith.
A famous woman blues singer. She had the show. And we ran away from Topeka, the state fair, and followed this woman and got on her show. Her name was Maul Rainey. This is way back in the 30s. Maul Rainey was the singingest, ugliest woman I ever seen in my life. Oh, her facials was nothing pretty or beautiful about her. But that voice and the song she sang, she was somebody's singer. And she's a wonderful, sweet lady. And I had the pleasure of working with blues to no blues, Bessie Smith. I tell them all the time that blues was recognized as women singers. They had the blues in the 20s and 30s. They were the great attraction of blues. Women, not men.
And Memphis Minnie was the other one that I thought was just superb, you know, her voice and everything, and she's sitting there playing her guitar. I thought that was wonderful, you know.
I met Memphis Minnie here at this in St. Louis. She was a friend to this man, his name was Willie. We call him Neck Bones. He and Minnie was old friends from down Memphis or somewhere. And that's where I first met her. And we would we'd go to his house and have jams. Never did get the chance to go to no club because she didn't stay put long enough.
Bama bee, won't you please come back to me?
Bama bee. Why don't you come back home? Well, you know you gotta stay long as midnight.
And I used to sit on the street corners and hear an Indianola and play, singing. And just sitting there, and you know, people coming by, they would request songs. And if you sang a gospel song, the people would always praise you highly. They'd pat you on the head and shoulders and say, "That was great, son. Keep it up. You're gonna be great one day." But they didn't put nothing in the hat. But people that ask you to sing blues would always put something in a hat and maybe give you a beer or something. At this time, I never heard the word superstar, but I was a superstar tractor driver. I was good. It was 9 of us tractor drivers that plowed the whole plantation. Now, I swear, I don't know how many acres, but it was acres, 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 acres.
If you ain't heard it, it sound like, you know, them old cotton field blues. That's what it is, them old tractor driving blues, you know. You're driving a tractor thinking about getting paid on Saturday, and you get the blues about that.
Oh, black man ain't got chain and clothes. Boy got drunk, closed that door. Oh, black man ain't got chain and clothes.
But one night, we went to one of those house parties. Fred McDowell was playing now, and I was back in the other room gambling. He'd been playing about 1 hour or 2 hours or something, and I know he didn't give out, you know. And I came out the gambling room in the back of there where my wife was, and he looked over there and told me, Fred did, you know, "Hey, Ariel, you want to play my guitar song?" I said, "Yeah, I'll play some." And that's what my wife told me, "You gonna get up here and make a fool out of yourself, boy, all these people here?" I said, "Yeah, I might well try it."
Going to Millbank, see that woolly fowl, reading them going, baby there, going to Melbourne, see that world affair.
And I got up and got his guitar and started to play, and had nobody around there who heard me play before, you know, in the public. Man, they started running all out of the kitchen dancing. Who is that playing the guitar now?
Need no heater, fireplace by my bed. Woman, I got cherry red. Need no heater, fireplace by my bed.
That's where I first met Robert Johnson at, was on Jefferson at Ernest Walker's place. Somehow or another, Ernest must have heard Robert playing somewhere, and he hired him along with me. And that's how we met. And we got together, and it wasn't no long time, but we hit it off pretty good, right quick.
I said, I flash your lights, mama. Your home don't even...
He was Lockwood's stepdaddy for a while. And he know just about what it is to know about him.
I started playing the guitar at 13 under Robert Johnson. And he'd leave and go out a couple of months and come back home. Everything he showed me, I'd be doing it. So he come home one time after I'd been playing about a year, and he carried me with him to Mississippi. And he carried me with him a place in Arkansas. We played a barn dance for a bunch of white people. And we came over to Mississippi, and they got a little river there called Sunflower River. He put me on one side of the bridge. He went on the other side. He said, we make more money this way. So when he got up on over there and come over there and got ready to go, I had about 35, 40 cents less than he had.
1937, the man picked him up on Johnson Street one Saturday evening. And Robert was standing on the streets about 1 o'clock. I came from the IC station on Johnson with my guitar on my shoulder. Young boy, I was 22 years old. Wasn't no yard 22. And Robert standing down by Harvard Street, Harvard and Johnson. There's a little alley along there, and the house was back in the alley. Old big woman back there sold whiskey called Emma. This woman come down the street, was half drunk. Hey, miss. Tall head drunk. Play me Tarplan Blues. She's doing like this. He said, miss, that's my record. She said, I don't care who it is. If you play it, you got a dime.
That Tarplan done a pretty good job. Now, he had some more out there that made it fairly good, but that Tarplan was his big deal.
His record was playing like everything on the jukebox. Nickel a wop. Or, of course, the nickel to play the jukebox. Nickel.
Keep on singing with Juba.
He was the best. There was no other.
All that across the room, tell them money. In the across room, tell them on my knee. Good old man, say me. Every beat, sun going down.
Robert Johnson fits a lot of cliches. Young, wild, knives, razors, guns, lots of chicks, lots of whiskey. Didn't live any place. I don't live any place either. I just travel from place to place. You got to keep moving. Blues are falling down like hell. He said, I said, you got to keep moving because you want to see something else.
Doggone, catch me. Nobody love me. Nobody seem to care.
My daddy was a Baptist minister, and he didn't allow me to play music. And so to begin with my music, he told me that was devil music, and he wouldn't let me play harmonica in our house.
In my household, the attitude towards the blues was the same as it was in nearly every household. You just did not do it, you know? It was called the devil's music, whatever that meant. And I often questioned that because I've gotten quite a few spankings by responding with saying, why does the devil have to get all the good stuff?
He didn't allow nothing like that in his house. The old man was what you call a preacher and what y'all call a natural born Christian in those days. Because he didn't understand a lot of things he didn't understand, you know what I mean? A lot of things he thought was bad was good. Of course, I finally convinced him on, you know, quite a few things after I left home, you know what I mean, and got kind of famous, you know what I mean. And then I used to buy him suits and shoes and different stuff like that. Well, that was great. And that come from my harmonica. And just like I said, it wasn't no devil music then, and it ain't no devil music now.
Hey. Oh, no. Yeah. Oh, no.
The first man I ever heard blow a harmonica was Sonny Boy Williams. He was coming down the road, tweet, tweet, tweet. Run down the road, met him, we come right along behind him, looking up at him, just watching him. And he blowing something like the train.
Rice Miller, which is Sonny Boy number two, was the best.
That was Rice Miller, but that wasn't a real Sonny Boy now. Real Sonny Boy was in Chicago.
Sonny Boy number two, you know, he had a tone and sound to music that don't nobody have.
He come to my house when Robert was living one time. And when Robert passed, then he started coming regular because I was playing good. And he wanted me to help him, you know, so. So he begged my mother to let me go to Mississippi with him.
And this place right here, behind me, this is the first place I saw Sonny Boy played harmonica, Sonny Boy number two, Rice Miller. First place, and I was 14 years old, 1929.
Wolf and Sonny Boy. They got the plane at this club, this plane for the bucket. What I mean? You set anything down there, hat, anything. So they put quarters, nickels, pennies. He said, Wolf, you play until I come back. I'm going to count this money. I'm going to, the bucket run nowhere. You know what I'm talking about? So but Sonny Boy goes to the bathroom and heists the window and goes out the window. It was a year later when he saw Sonny Boy. Wolf said he looked for him that whole year with a double barrel shotgun. Then he hears Sonny Boy comes back. Greenwood come back. Wolf said he looked at him. So he said, hey, man, you know, I seen a time 2 months ago you'd have been dead. Sonny Boy, well, you know I was. I don't know why I did it. I just got greedy. Yeah, Wolf said, yeah. See, you'd have been a dead dude, man, if I had found you 2 months ago.
I tried to fetch religion, but you wouldn't even let me pray. I wanted to refresh religion, but woman, you know you won't let me pray. If you don't be mighty careful, the devil gonna get you one day.
Sonny Boy number two was broadcasting down in Helena, Arkansas, using Sonny Boy's number one name.
And when I got to Helena, Sonny Boy had been on the air for for about 3 days by itself. And I joined him. And we was on King Biscuit time about 6 months and found Peck. And in a couple of weeks, I bought Peck some drums.
Sonny Boy number one went from Chicago down to Helena, Arkansas, and took him off the air and stopped him from using his name. And later on, some kind of way, the company and them, they made a deal. He was using Sonny Boy number one name and everything. Everybody thought Sonny Boy number two. That's how they got it straightened out. That's how come they call Sonny Boy. Otherwise, it never would have been straightened out now. Sonny Boy number one went from Chicago down to Helena, Arkansas, and pulled Sonny Boy number two off there from King Biscuit. Did you understand that?
We'd come on the air, you know, I'd be the first one to hit it, you know. And key of A, we'd say, good evening, everybody, tell them how do you do. The King Biscuit boys come out to welcome you.
We would hear King Biscuit time, and they had it planned well because it would be at 12:15.
That was 5 days every week. Every week, 5 days.
And we would be coming out of the fields at, we call it coming in for dinner. You know, sophisticated people say lunch today, you know, but to me it's still dinner. You come out of the fields for dinner and you have an hour off. 15 minutes after you get there, and we'd be hurrying to get to the house, you know, your home, wherever you lived, if you had a radio.
So I had a lot of guys on King Biscuit time before I left. I had Joe Willie Wilkins. And I taught Joe Willie how to play with Sonny Boy.
But you could listen to anybody, sit on anybody's porch, as we call it, and you'd hear Sonny Boy Williamson, King Biscuit time, from Helena, Arkansas.
Well, that, you know, if morning for breakfast, I have King Biscuit on my table, invite my friends and all my next door neighbors. Boy, he could sing that too.
Now had an evening, train been gone for how long? How long, babe, how long?
Ain't but two of us living was on that program now. It's me and Robert Jr. Lockwood, on us two living. Joe Willie Wilkins, Jamie Peck Curtis, Sonny Boy, and Houston Stackhouse, all gone. But I'm glad to be here.
And I'm gonna sing this time, darling. Ain't gonna sing no more. Now my time will roll around. I believe I've got to go. For how long? How long? Babe, how long?
A lot of these guys, that's where they got a lot of their stuff from, a lot of their licks from Robert Jr. Lockwood. Robert Jr. Lockwood was top cat then on the guitar.
I've always liked guitar, and to hear Robert Jr., Robert Jr. Lockwood was with him at that time. Ooh. I just started fantasizing, dreaming, God, if I could just play a little bit like him.
Sun go down in the evening, baby, when the sun go down, it's hard to tell, it's hard to tell, when your lover's not around, when the sun goes down. When I went down south, I stopped in Tunica, and I went in Hard Face's restaurant. and ordered some food. I had an electric guitar and an amplifier. And a lady went over to the jukebox to play a song. And Hardface asked her, why didn't she give me that money? She said, why don't you give that money to this man? I said, he might be able to play what you want to hear. She said, if he played Take a Little Walk with Me, I'd take him home with me. That was my song. And I said, Take a Little Walk with Me? I had never heard my own song. See, at that time when you made a record, you didn't get no playbacks. Whoever you was working for, if they said it was okay, that was it. So I went on back and sat down and told the lady, I said, I think I can play it. And I hit that introduction, that woman's mouth fell open. Goodbye, sweetheart and friend. Yes, I'm going away. I'll be back to see you some long or long time. In the evening, baby, when the sun go down, when the sun go down.
I told you when I was about 8 years old, I seen an old fella was playing a guitar acoustic, coming through the neighborhood. He had played for somebody called a supper that somebody was having, had that night, that Saturday night, and he was on his way back home that Sunday morning. And he hadn't stopped by our house to get a cup of coffee or something, you know. Like my grandmother, she always had a little bootleg liquor around, somebody, you know, nobody come out and get a little drink or something. And so he been around and played a few numbers. They fed him, you know, get him some food and some coffee and give him a little toddy. He got on his way, you know. Throw his old guitar across his back. But, man, he just playing that. I was looking at him. That's my first time I ever seen that. And it just got all over me. I'm telling you, that's what I'm telling you. It rolled me night and day. It jumped on me.
Well, a juke joint is these little old places where people ain't able to build them no club. And so they take any kind of little house and set it up, you know, me and a high musician or get them a jukebox and put in there, you know, one of them vendors and put in there. And then they sell moonshine, whiskey, beer, and fish and stuff, you know, like that, you know what I mean.
Night and day. About the music, just a feeling that you get from it. It's a feeling. You don't get it often, but every once in a while, you pick that feeling. You get a feeling within you, and man, you just feel real good.
Every day, I had a blue.
Well, St. Louis always has been indifferent for most towns. I tried to live out of St. Louis. Not that I couldn't live out, but I just couldn't get St. Louis out of a system. Lonnie Johnson lived here. Peter Wheatstraw was really popular. Roosevelt Sykes was popular. By the middle of the 30s, Roosevelt had made a pretty good hit. I was employed with Roosevelt for the reason of Roosevelt. At that time, he had the tendency to gain speed as he started. He'd take one tempo, and when he quit, he'd be way up there, you know. And this is what I was hired to do, is to hold him, to keep him from running away. He wasn't gonna stay long. If he'd done three nights, or whatever, that was the end of it. He had a little weight, he, well, mule, maybe we better move. I said, what's the matter? Just ready to move, mule. I guess most people has heard that if you can't live in St. Louis, you can't live nowhere, because everything was in the mud for cheap, and you could always find a place to stay.
Things happen strangely. I don't see how it can be. Things happen strangely. Don't see how it can be. But it's been happening to me all my whole lifetime. Everything wrong happened to me.
There was a place on the river for what's called roustabouts, and they had all prices that you wanted, you could sleep there, no regardless. If you had anything, if you had a nickel, you could sleep there. But the way they slept, and it's kind of difficult to believe, but this is true, it's not nothing made up. For a dollar, you could get a cot, sleep on just like you do in a hotel, but you see everybody, a lot of other people out there. For 50 cents, you could get an easy sitting chair. For a quarter, you could get double ropes. You've heard of that? You slept on two ropes, one on this arm, one on that arm. You stood up and slept. For a dime, you could sleep on one rope, stand up and sleep. You couldn't lay down on the floor. You had to be placed in one of those places. And you believe it or not, it's a lot of people. You mentioned around, and mention St. Louis, and some of the old timers or some of the young people have heard of this, sleeping on the rope.
Well, they've been giving me trouble so long. Well, 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 they've been giving me trouble so long. I've been having the same trouble ever since I've been a man of grown.
Blues comes in a many form. It can come negative or positive. Now, I hear a lot of guitar players say that blues is a feeling. Perhaps so, the way they play it. It's a feeling, their feeling. Positive, I'm helping others rather than asking for help myself. That's the Okadoka style.
It's hard to play by yourself.
Lord Fulton, I've always liked his work. One of the main tunes that he recorded, which I did later, was Reconsider. And it always was a tune that people could identify with because of the story.
So long. Oh, I hate to see you go.
I was called the Prince of the Blues. But see, I used to sing sentimental songs. It was blue, but it wasn't the blues, because blues are 12 bars. I sang songs with a bridge to them, with love songs, but they were blue songs. I was a romantic blues ballad singer. Most people don't remember me, but when you say, Merry Christmas, baby. Oh, yeah, that's the guy, yeah.
Merry Christmas, baby. Sure did treat me nice. Gave me a diamond ring for Christmas. Now I'm living in paradise.
We boys elevated blues to first-class entertainment. The first one was a guitar player named T-Bone Walker. The next one, so outstanding, Joe Williams. Winona Harris, Clean Head Vincent, Louis Jordan, and the Timothy Five. And of course, Joe Turner.
Well, I'm from the country, baby. Get blowed into your bread big time. Baby, it's loaded to your bread big down. Well, I heard about you, baby, and I know what you've been putting down. Yeah.
These were the fellas that come up in my days and when we were blues singing, dressed up first class. I'm one of the early men that start singing blues other than in the honky-tonkies. Or in the joints. I wore whitetail suits, you know, classy, dressed up in it. I never run down a woman. I talked about how sweet a woman is. I washed the children's clothes. I sent the children to school. I stayed up all night with the baby. I washed her dirty clothes with the climax. But when it's time to go to bed, that woman grabbed me so tight, took me in my arms and squeezed me with all my might. I called me lots of sweet names, and then I turned off all the light, and that woman set my soul on fire. And I said, baby, that's all right. Everything's all right. That's why I love a woman. That's how that come up.
Did you ever love a woman? Yes, and love her with all your might. And you knew that all the time. That woman wouldn't treat you right.
In the beginning, down in Virginia and North Carolina, the audiences were usually mixed, but segregatedly mixed. Spectators' audiences, which were usually upstairs, and sometime if there were barns and warehouses that we sometime played the carnivals, the dividing line was a rope down the center of the hallway. And the rope separated the races from dancing side by side. And there would be a paper or cardboard or something on each side of that rope. One side would say white and one would say colored. In those days, we were colored, you see. And that rope would remain intact until sometime the music got to be so awe-inspiring that the rope would drop down and people would just continue dancing, having a wonderful time, not even looking around to see who was next and who was bumping you, until some police officer or some authority would go up and grab the microphone and stop the music. And a couple of times I had the mic snatched out of my hand because the rope had fallen. And until the rope was put back in place, the dance came to a halt. It's a new day now, I guess. The meanest man I've ever
known. It was not rock and roll that made Memphis famous. It was Beale Street and the Blues.
Walking down Beale Street was, oh man, a day of learning. Beale Street was like a community college. Everything was going on. You were being taught everything. And some of the best musicians you would see in Memphis, whether they be jazz, blues, or what have you, they would stop in Memphis. At that time, which I didn't know too much about, was how to survive in a city. They had a place called a 1 minute cafe. 1 minute mean they get everything you need in 1 minute. A nickel for crackers, nickel for something to drink, 15 cent for chili, and that's enough to last you all day. For a quarter, you could eat good.
Everything went on here in Beale Street. This is the new Beale Street now. But this is where all the blues and all the good times was down here. The opportunity that I had to get my first start was at the Palace Theater, where they had the amateur shows on Wednesday night, and that's where I got started.
When I think of the Palace Theater, Rufus Thomas was the MC.
That was a little country boy, came out of a town called Indianola, Mississippi, had a regular guitar on his shoulder and holes in his shoes.
I lived in Orange Mound at that time in Memphis area, and Orange Mound from downtown had to be 2-3 miles or more.
And every Wednesday night, the same raggedy boy, he had a job, wanted to be your own amateur night on Beale Street.
And believe it or not, I was standing at that back door every Wednesday night, because if you could get that dollar, you didn't have to win, and I never did. But they would give you a dollar each time you appeared.
To get a dollar meant a lot, because a dollar could last you, I don't know, 4 or 5 days.
So if I got that dollar, I could ride the bus every morning to work. I worked at Newberry Equipment Company. Then I could walk back in the evening. You know, you got plenty of time, but a lot of time you wake up late and I got this long way to go. So I needed that dollar, and I'd go back, come backstage and say, Rufus, please, he's Bill, he was just here last week, Rufus, please. All right, and he'd call me a dirty name and let me come on.
I don't know, fate again steps in.
But he did it. He always never turned me away. He scolded me, though. He'd give me a fit.
To me, he was always good. I just loved the way he played that guitar and sang.
I love the guy. I'll always love him because he helped me so much. He really did.
And then along with B.B. came Bobby Bland.
We'd live for that Wednesday night. You had to have something different, you know, every Wednesday night, a different tune. Maybe you can get by 2 nights, but then you got to do somebody else's material, you know. So I had quite a few people that I liked, you know, and that I listened to. So it wasn't a problem for me, because I could, well, I got a gal lived up on the hill, Big Joe Turner, Roy Brown, Hard Luck Blues, Charles Brown, Black Knight, T-Bone Walker. I had a lot of people that I had been listening to, you know, so it wasn't a thing that I didn't have no material to do, you know, because I would stay right by the jukebox all the time, man, trying to get new material for that Wednesday night.
And Bobby Bland, as you know, is one of the premier blues singers in the world today.
Wednesday night.
mixtapes all covered, so you take it like you find it. Now you can leave it just like it is, and that's the way you say it's always been. That's the way you know it.
Radio station WDIA was a big plus for Memphis. It's one of the greatest things ever happened to the city.
They had an idea. They changed it from country music to the first all-black operated station in the South, I know.
And remember, when I was on WDIA, it was 250 watts. They had raised that baby up to 50,000 watts.
They had a DJ, and his name was Rufus Thomas.
I won't forget that time.
We also had B.B. King was a DJ at that time.
He was disc jockeying as B.B. King, the blues boy. He was advertising Pepticon.
He was the Pepticon boy. That's how he got famous. Playing his guitar and singing for Pepticon. Pepticon was a medicine that healed everything. All you had to do was take it on time.
My first jingle I ever wrote.
Maybe you heard the song. Pepticon sure is good. Pepticon sure is good.
Pepticon sure is good. You can get it anywhere in your neighborhood.
Look all around me. Hey, my baby, she can't be found. You know I don't find my baby. People, I'm going down to the bowl of God.
We got this Greyhound bus and rode to Chicago. And the only thing that I had to bring with me was a box of Ritz crackers and 35 cents in my pocket. And when that Greyhound bus got to 63rd Street here in Chicago, I looked up and I said, good God, this must be heaven.
Well, I came to Chicago September 25th, 1957. I wasn't looking to be a guitar player. I was my mother at got sick, and they told me I could get a job up here and make twice or maybe three times the money I was making working days in Louisiana. Have you ever been mistreated? Well, then you know just what I'm talking about. Listen. Lord, if you ever, Lord, have you ever been mistreated? Then you know just what, Lord, what I'm talking about. Yeah. Lord, I worked 5 long years for one woman. And she had to. To put me out. I also wanted to meet the great blues players. I had found out I was living here. They had 1 million joints and 2 million musicians. Lord, I got a job at a steel mill, woman. Trucking steel just like a slave. 5 long years every Friday, woman, I went straight home, but I, Lord!
When I came back to Chicago, November the 16th, 1945, when I was discharged out of service, I went down on 504 South State Street in Chicago and bought me a PA system. and it had two speakers. And that's when I went to Maxwell Street by myself alone. 3 months later came on Floyd Jones. 3 months later there came on Moody Jones and joined me. Then I came out with the small mic. I came out with the small mic that you hold in your hand like you see people's playing now. And that's how that harmonica got mic'd, not by Little Walter, by Snooky Pryor.
One day, I was walking down Silver Street. I heard the boogie right around the corner. Boy, it took me off my feet. I had the boogie too.
Michael Street, it was just like going to the Louisiana Jazz Fest on Sunday. They say all the blues players would be out there, you know, playing. You just walk down the street, and it had the street blocked off, and they were selling things out there, you know, real cheap.
And they sold some of everything that you wanted to buy, and some of everything that they got in this world, they had it down there on Maxwell Street. Down there on Maxwell Street, I had all the crowd. I'm not kidding, we used to make, I ain't talking about one shoebox, I'm talking about shoeboxes of money down there on the streets.
The first time that I sit in with the Howling Wolf, Willie Dixon happened to be in the audience. When I finished singing, he walked over to me. He said, "Who is you?" And I told him. He said, "Well, I'm Willie Dixon. I'm the A&R man, songwriter for Chess Records." He said, "You know, I never heard a woman sing the blues like you sing the blues." He said, "And that's what the world needs today." He called me up in the middle of the night. "Hey, Coke, I want you to come on over, because I got this song I done wrote for you. And we need to get working on it. It's 1 o'clock at night in the morning." And I'm going like, what song is this so important that we can't wait until tomorrow to do it? You know, "Wang Dang Doodle. I just wrote this song. And we got to do it tonight." "Why tonight?" He said, "We got to pick the chicken while the water's hot."
Tell Automatic Slim to tell Razor Toting Jim to tell Butcher Knife Toting Annie to tell Fast Talking Fanny, we gonna pitch a ball now down to that Union Hall. We gonna romp and trump till midnight. We gonna fuss and fight till daylight. We gon' pitch a wang dang doodle all night long. 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 We gon' pitch a wang dang doodle all night long.
Chess told me we done sold 1 million copies. That's all y'all must be talking about, somebody else, you know. The Temptations or somebody. It couldn't be me. I couldn't believe it.
We gon' pitch a wang dang doodle all night long. Let's go home.
It was always fun with the Chess Brothers. Always fun.
I tell you what, they cussed me out there, but every time I got ready to record, you know, in the studio, yes, sir, they did this. Them Chess Brothers.
People were calling each other names and joking with each other and all that kind of shit, all the time.
When I first sit down in the studio, if you would start playing something, and we didn't go down and rehearse or none of that stuff, they would come up and hum this stuff to you and what they wanted you to play right there. And if they thought you wasn't playing it right or a little too loud or don't come in here, come in there.
"Hey, you SOB, you turn it down, turn it down, turn that stuff down."
I lost the fact that my name was Buddy, because they would get on the microphone in the engineer's room, which had a glass between you and them, and they would call you the motherfucker.
Cause I remember he called me a lot of times.
Say, hey, you motherfucker. You coming in too early.
The guy scared the hell out of me. Really, he scared me to death, man.
And I'm sitting back there saying, wonder who they talking to. And you'd have to look up and they would be pointing. I'm talking to you, motherfucker. And then all of a sudden they say it again. And I look up, I say, well, maybe I'm the only motherfucker Indian. And you look up, he's pointing at Muddy or Wolf or who's part.
One thing about Lennon, he records you. And if the record was any way decent, he pushed it and made it be a hit.
I remember him telling me one time about the monies that different artists had there. Not necessarily in escrow, but I guess you could say in escrow. And he was saying that all they would have to do was ask for it.
And a lot of people hold a few things against him because, what can I say? He paid himself back.
So I was real charming with Howlin' Wolf, and I went back, told him. And Wolf went back and told Leonard about it. So I think I was in Texas or somewhere. He called around till he found me, had the secretary to find me. Told me I needed to get in, you know. When I caught a plane and came in, oh, he was hot.
He made your record be a hit? When he owed him something.
And he told me that how disappointed he was that I had divulged what he and I talked about. These guys have been here a long time and they're happy with the way things are. So you can't tell them anything, leave them alone. And I never mentioned anything else again. Really got acquainted with Wolf's music was when he recorded How Many More Years. That was a big, big hit.
She got herself a young man.
What that mean?
She don't want none of this here no more.
Oh, have mercy.
When I got with him, he was a small guy. You know what I mean? And all of a sudden, man, he just got up there. 325, you know, that 325. But like he said, when we made 300 pounds, a muscle and joy.
Well, he did one of the best shows that you wouldn't never forget because he did a lot of unusual things, you know.
This man was such a great entertainer that all of us young bucks, nobody wanted to go on behind him.
He sang Spoonful, then he get out on his knees with his mic, man. Then he goes back to this bag, which we got a spoon that big. you know, waiting on him. Because, you know, that's the kind of show, man, he put on every night.
When I was going right, you could believe a word I say. When I'm doing right, you could believe a word I say.
I could shake his booty, man, better than one of those cheerleaders, man. I'm just telling you what I'm talking about. The man had a mind, I keep telling you, some stuff, man. He could hear you a bad note. He'll bring your ass down, man. He gonna bring your ass down, or you better not make a nothing. But he was a scary dude, man. Cause they call it the devil's music. When they got the wolf, it was the devil's music. It was low down, a real low, the lowest they could get.
Hubert Sumlin!
The most hardest thing in the world for anybody to play. Everybody can't play the blues. You think they can. They think they can. But they ain't. You playing the blues. Sure, you is. Ain't no soul left. Soul is the foundation of this whole thing, man. And what you say is your bond. You know, what you say is your bond. If you don't live it, if you don't live this stuff, you ain't got 'em.
The gypsy woman told my mother before I was born, I got a boy child coming. He's gonna be a son of a gun.
When I came to Chicago, my first experience was hungry. I ran out of money and didn't have any food, and a stranger taking me to a famous club called the 708 Club. That's 708 East 47th Street. And that was Otis Rush on the stage. And he called me up, and I went up and played Things I Used to Do in a Jim Reed song. And the owner was picking up his receipts, and he says, whoever that is, hire him. And I played the two songs. I walked off the stage with my guitar. Just as I got ready to go out the door, somebody just reached up and got me in the collar and says, I done got out of my motherfucking bed to come here to hear you. And I hear you talking about you hungry and got to go back. He came out with this loaf of bread and a big stack of nice cut salami. He said, Muddy Waters. And you hungry? I said, not if you Muddy Waters, I'm not hungry. You know, I'm full. Well, Muddy was like a dad, not only to me, to Junior Wells, James Cardner, whoever played with him.
Muddy Waters was really my inspiration. I loved it. That old man, he taught me so much about my music.
He was like, wouldn't tell you I'm teaching you. If you had any sense, you sit back there and know he was teaching you.
Had a pretty little girl, but I lose my baby boy, ain't that bad. Boy, they're that bad.
that you ain't got. Can't lose something little girl that you ain't never had.
Muddy, the Wolf, Walter, we all would go to different clubs at night. We never got a chance to play together. So when we started the Blue Monday, you would wake up on a Blue Monday and you'd find Sonny Boy, Junior, Walter Halton, Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, myself, Magic Sam, and Otis Rush sitting there. And if I had the little house band, I would go from Sonny Boy and tell him, I said, Walter say you ain't got no business in the house. And he would look around, did that motherfucker say that? And I'd say, yeah. And then I'd walk off to Walter, and I'd say, Sonny Boy, what are they talking about? You say, when he in the house, you should stay home and go to bed. And after I get them all riled up, I would go and start the band up, and they would come one by one, man. And I wish they could have recorded that. Them were some of the best sounding days, because they were blowing after one another, you know?
When he went to Chicago, Muddy Waters was like, think of dropping a pebble in a lake. Think of a lake that's very still, and you drop this pebble, and the waves start. That's what Muddy Waters did for the blues in Chicago.
And a sweet little home. But it got went down, people ain't that bad. That's my own fault. People ain't that bad. You can't spend what you ain't got.
In a little club so I could bring people in. The owner said, well, since you play, you pick the traditional acts, and he would pick what he called the commercial acts. So I had a field day. Well, I knew where Brownie, Sonny, Jack Dupree, Josh White, Gary Davis.
Pete Bunk Blues, the East Coast Blues is what they call it. Some people call it cotton picking, and some call it East Coast Blues, some call it Piedmont Blues. And people like Mississippi John Hurt, Elizabeth Cotton.
Contrary to popular beliefs, coffee houses and that whole scene didn't have people for months. And there wasn't 10 million of them in the late 50s and the early 60s. They only started to explode when people found Mississippi John Hurt.
He was just a little tiny man. He wasn't much taller than that. And he could sit in the straight back chair. And when he was playing, he could rock that chair just same as he was in a rocking chair.
And John, because of playing like... was close to the folkies' head during a folk boom. They assumed that that style was close to their head. He became like a god.
All we play, gather round, the good sweet candy man's in town, is the candy man. Candyman. Got the candy, his money's long. Sell his bags, hog his cone. Did the Candyman. Candyman. I said, you and the candy man are getting mighty fickle. Uh-huh. You must be stuck on the candy man.
When I went to pick up Lightnin' Hopkins for his first gig, I knocked on the door of the hotel room and I said, Mr. Hopkins, I came to pick you up. Then he hollered out, who the hell are you? So I got a little confused. I said, well, our name is Jerry Ricks, and I'm the boy to pick you up. He wouldn't answer. So I said, listen, River, open the door. So he pulled the door open really fast. He said, who told you that? Because I called him River. because they all call each other River for friendship. And I knew the old little line that the bluesmen used to call each other. And if they don't call you River, that means the river dried up and the friendship is over.
Boom, 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 boom. I'm gonna shoot you right down. Right off of your feet. Take you home with me. Put you in my house. Boom, 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 boom. I love to see you struck. Up and down the floor. When you're talking to me, that baby talk.
You ain't nothing but a hound.
Big Mama Thorn was a pretty rough lady to work around, man. She, we was in Vesma, Alabama. She got mad with the promoter and whipped the promoter and his daughter. She was a good character.
Where the black music didn't sell, they sold it. You know what I'm talking about? Carl Perkins and Everett Presley sold it.
When Elvis recorded Hound Dog, I was amazed because I knew from whence it came. I knew Big Mama Thornton very well, and I knew the intensity of the original done by Mama Thornton.
Elvis taking it and sending it to the moon, you know? And she got $500 out the whole thing.
At this time when I saw her, she was working in a club in Los Angeles, kind of walking the floor with a cup, singing for handouts. You know what I'm saying? When it got down and Elvis heard it and Jerry Lee Lewis heard it, okay? Roy Orbison heard it. Everybody kind of got on that train, you see? And it was permissible then for everybody to listen to it.
You can wag your tail, but I ain't gonna feed you no more.
Well, every time I see those guys now, the British guys, I thank them for what they did because they took the music that Muddy Waters, not myself, and the Howlin' Wolf and Sonny Boy and all those people had made famous with the black people and brought it to a different listening audience, which is white people. And Ed Sullivan brought the Stones on and all that. And then they got so famous they came back here and said, hey, I'll do a television show if you bring Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters on with me. And white America was asking, who in the hell is that?
Howlin' Wolf was one of our greatest idols, and it's a great pleasure to find you being booked on this show tonight. It really is a pleasure.
Thanks to Howlin' Jack Wood.
So I think it's about time you shut up and we had Howlin' Wolf on stage.
Yeah,
and like Richard always says, rhythm and blues had a baby and they called it rock and roll. Because that's what it was in the beginning. And before that, it was just mainstream race music.
It'll be going on till the end of the world. Because all the music going on now, you know, that rap, disco, rock and roll, all that come from the blues. They just pep the time up on it, you know. Oh, this 12-bar blues, they just pep the timing up on it. It's still the blues, you know.
Hey, it was going to be what it's going to be. And that's what it was, man.
Them blues is something like no other kind of music, no other kind of thing when it's put to music. Blues in a class by itself.
I don't think there's any individual on the face of the earth can give you not just one and only one definition for the blues, and it'll stand.
Now, when a person, as I want to say, is deprived from everything, the walk of life, ain't got sufficient home, no food, no way to clothe his children and to feed them, you know what I mean? That's the blues.
All blues is not a sad blues. When you hear B.B. King saying, I got a sweet little angel, that don't sound too sad to me.
Yeah, blues is a feeling, that's all it is.
Hey, hey, the blues is all right, say it. Hey, hey, the blues is all right.
Grandfather, he loved the blues, you know, and he always would be singing the blues. Sometime him and my grandmother, they never would fuss and fight, you know, just have a fight. But they would have a argument, they'd get in a big argument on a thing, and she wouldn't cook for him or for us. And he'd get to singing some blues, and next thing you know, she's starting a fire in the stove, finna get ready to start cooking some cornbread, gonna feed him, you know. So I started studying the blues on that. I said, wow, you know.
That's what I love is the blues. That's why I live with the blues. Every day I have the blues.
We was born with the blues. We grew up with the blues. And some of us gonna die with the blues.
Something you heard in the sound, that sound we call blues, you probably hear the same thing in the spirituals, but we're talking about blues. You're still hearing that whole thing. It's something you hear from a cry from black culture. And you're experiencing that same cry because we're all part of that same mess. These two cultures coming together, these two continents. It's European culture, African culture coming together. We're part of this whole thing. It's like I said, we can run, but we can't hide.
Everybody can have the blues. Anybody can have the blues. Just because you are a white man and you come home from your office, your white shirt, you know, the white collar and suit and everything, and you come home from work, take your key, but first you park your car, because you got yourself a big, nice car. You park your car in your two-car garage. First thing you see is not the other car. Take your key, open your door. When that door is open, you look into your house, and there is nothing, no furniture. And you go to the kitchen and you see nothing. Your woman is gone and the children are gone. She's even taken the linoleum up off the floor. She's even taken the salt out of the shaker. And just because you white, you think you ain't got the blues?
Run your mama. Got to have a word with you. I just want you to tell me why you treat me the way you do.
And I'm a little concerned now. They say we're going to go into the schools and teach the children the blues. I want them to teach them about the blues. Don't teach them the blues. They don't need that. They don't have the reasons to sing them that I had. And hopefully they will never have it again. Hopefully that bill has been paid.
If you want to know, will blues ever leave?
No. Never.
And the blues never will die. It'll be going on till the end of the world.
Yeah, it's a lot of ways you can have the blues. It's a lot of ways. And it's gonna live. And it's gonna live until the end of everybody. With everybody. Till everybody leaves this earth, man. It's gonna be here. So that's why I say today that blues belongs to the world. I said the world.
Why don't you reconsider, baby? Give yourself just a little more time. that's about all I got to give.
You had them fooled, baby. Found out you was wrong.